A very good morning to all of you, those of you that are here with me here this morning and those that are watching at home. If you'll notice, we'll get this over with very, very quickly. Yes, I am wearing a very, very bright tie. Yay! Well, my credo has always been the world. However, in the USA, it is a weekend where it is Memorial Day weekend. For those of you that are not residents of the United States that are watching in from other countries, once a year we take and honor those people that have contributed both life and limb, quite literally, to helping the freedom and the democracy upon which the United States was founded to continue. And the people that have served in the military, those that have in some way contributed to the health and the well-being of other people that they may live in a peaceful type of state. And particularly we have memorialized people in the First World War, the Second World War, into the Korean War, the Vietnam War, other skirmishes, the current conflict that is taking place in Iraq and Afghanistan. Whether a person believes in the current war situation or not, the one thing we all share is that young men and women are giving life and limb for the purpose of peace in their own mind. And one thing I'd like to mention, in the mysteries of life, all of us are born for a unique purpose. The Bhagavad Gita is the Hindu gospel, the equivalent of the New Testament. And in that particular gospel, there is a passage where the Christ incarnate equivalent of India is carrying on a discourse with his disciple, and a big battle is about to take place. And the disciple cannot reconcile in their own mind why this battle is going to take place, where bloodshed and death and so forth will occur. And Krishna turns to him and says, to a warrior there is nothing more righteous than a noble war. To a warrior there is nothing more righteous than a noble war. What this really means is that all of us have a destiny. Doesn't mean that everybody's name will be in headlines or that a person will be known worldwide. But all of us are born for a specific reason. And that reason is part of the whole tapestry of what we call life. To those that serve in the military, whether it's in this country or any country, in their own minds, in their own consciousness, be it right or wrong, their leaders have instilled in their consciousness the idea of this is a noble cause, a righteous cause, etc., etc. It is as if certain souls are born to serve in the military. Those certain souls were born for that particular purpose. People who give their lives for other people are born to do this. It is as if there is a destiny that exists throughout all of nature. A destiny that can be seen even in the lower kingdoms, where you have the worker ants, you have the queen bee, you have all different systems within the different kingdoms of nature. And thus we as human beings are not excluded from this. Each of us is born for a unique purpose. And indeed, some serve in the military. And it doesn't necessarily mean that we're not honoring them if they don't give the ultimate price of their life. Because some will give an emotional cost. Some will give a cost of limb or some other disease that they take forth from their giving. And again, this is not confined to those of you that are watching in other countries, to the United States. Because I feel that in a spiritual sense, we honor all people in all nations who have given in their own minds for a righteous cause life and limb. And now let's take a few moments to work upon the health of our bodies. I'm going to ask that those of you that are here, if you sit back in your chairs, either put both feet flat on the floor or your ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable for you. And just think along with me as we concentrate inwardly. I turn away for a few moments from the outer world that I may focus the entirety of my attention on the inner world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. And as I do this now, I let loose to the natural healing power of universal mind, spirit of God here within myself. I recline back into that comfort zone where all is peace, all is balance, all is wholeness, and all is completeness. As I do, I allow that natural healing power to move throughout the entirety of my body, into every nerve, cell, and tissue of my body. And as I do, I become comfortable and at peace. At peace with that greater presence that created my body, maintains my body, heals my body. Let me feel that that presence is as an inner light that exists at the very center of my mind, that that inner light is entering into the nucleus of every one of the millions of cells of my body, from the crown of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. And that light is the powerful primal light energy of the universe that controls all the energy factors of all created things, inclusive of my physical body, and that all of the energy factors within all of the millions of cells of my body are now being adjusted, renewed, into a perfect balance and harmony as the divine architect of the universe designed my body to work in a healthy way and fashion, so all of the energy within every cell is adjusted to the perfect health pattern as ordained by the grand architect of the universe that designed my body temple, that breathed life into my body temple. I am part of that uniqueness. I am its expression. I am the holy and the sacred that lives within me, expressed perfectly through my body. I am the beauty of the wholeness, the completeness of infinite, eternal, universal life. I am God's perfect expression, expressed through my body, from the crown of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. Where I am, God is. I am God's perfection in body and in mind. physical expression of the greatness that is life universal. For this realization of health and wholeness throughout my body, I give thanks. I let it be so, and so it is. This morning's subject deals with memories of the past and of the future. Now, that seems rather contradictory. We can remember certainly the past, but the future? How can we remember memories of the future if the future is yet to be? In the mysteries of time and space, matter and energy, soul and spirit, human and divine, time doesn't exist as we comprehend it in our human perception. Time is really a relative thing, and past and present and future exist as one eternal moment. Sometimes people have said, why is it that certain people have seen into the future? How is it that they've caught glimpses of things that were yet to be? The only way you can see something if it's already there. Think about that. The only way that you could see something into the future, if you had some type of marvelous ability, whether it was lifelong or whether it was just a spontaneous thing that at one point happened, the only way you could do this is if that future already existed. And the truth is that our future already exists. So you say, well, if the future already exists, why aren't I living in it? You are living in it. It's just that you're not aware of it. Well, you say, well, how could that be? Well, let's suppose that you had a glimpse of the future, whether it was about yourself or something else. You had some precognitive experience. The only way you could have it is if that future already existed. And so, when it comes to honoring memories or paying attention to memories, we can also pay attention and honor memories that already exist, because the future already exists. Now, some of you might say, oh my gosh, isn't that predestination? Isn't that everything is already set in stone? In our human consciousness, we tend to isolate ourselves from our Creator presence. The Creator presence is God within ourselves. Our ultimate state of beingness is our Creator. The Creator alone has the will for everything to be, and what will be has been and exists in one eternal moment. In an intellectual state of isolation, we believe and make up myths that we really have a control over what we will be or won't be. The truth is, as hard a pill as it is for somebody to take, is that we intellectual isolation entities have no control because we are not the real life living in the body. The real life living in the body is the universe that has already made up its mind as to what this particular carcass that we are residing in is going to do in this lifetime. Now, in order to be able to say that, well, you say, well, why then strive for anything? Because that's part of what already exists. Why try to be better? Because that's part of what already exists. Why try to unfold your soul? Because that's part of what already exists. Jesus was very, very subtle with his disciples. Try to explain this to him. Because, of course, with every striving that we take, with this intellectual isolation, we think in our intellectual BB brains that we can make something happen. Jesus was very clear. It's in the New Testament. Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to their stature? What you ever will be, you already are. Whatever you could conceive yourself to ever be, you already are. So, if you're not feeling like you have good health, you already are healthy. If you feel you're too thin or overweight, you already are the perfect weight. But you say, well, how do I get from point A to point B? You drop the facade of intellectual isolation. How do you do that? You cuddle up to God. There was a song years ago, cuddle up a little closer. I murdered it, but that's all right. You get the idea. The closer we get to the presence of God, the more we assume the reality and we stop this sense of intellectual isolation, which makes us feel that God is one thing, we are something else. And for those of you that are metaphysically inclined, don't think it stops with only a mental situation. So I call that cerebral metaphysics. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Those that are pure in heart shall see God. It is a matter of what is inside of here. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. What goes on in the heart? The presence of God. We become one with the presence of God through our daily meditations, which we take more seriously than eating, than exercising. Loving, we take it more seriously than anything. This time that we have to break this thing of intellectual isolation from our source is what we really need, which is already ours. So we already are healthy. It's the intellectual isolation that prevents us from this. It's the intellectual isolation that has brainwashed or self-brainwashed us into believing that we are sickly. It is the intellectual isolation that has brainwashed us into believing we're too thin or too much, too fat. I mean, come on, let's say it as it is. And yet inside of every one of us is this perfect God and this perfect goddess. And so that is the expression of God. Sometimes people will have visions. They'll see a perfect Christ-like figure in a male body, or they'll see a perfect goddess-like figure. That's you. That's you. That's what you really look like. That's the real archetypal part of you. You're perfect. The image of God within God's self is perfect. You are Alpha and Omega. In the reality of who and what any of us are, we are perfect already. We are part of the future that already is. We are healed, we are whole, we are content, we are fulfilled, we are loved, we are joyful, and it is only the stupidity of intellectual isolation from our source that keeps us chained to a life of quiet desperation. The choice is every one of ours. Once we get to a point where we can say, to hell with our personal ego, and mean it, to say, I've had enough, I've psychically bled enough, I don't want this anymore. I see the futility of it, the stupidity of it. It causes fear. It causes confusion. It causes hate. It causes jealousy. It causes envy. And it doesn't matter whether you tote a Bible around or Quran around or a Gita around. Those books don't mean anything. It's what's in your heart, what's in your consciousness. Toting those things around is just for the sake of others. Be ye not as the hypocrites, seen in the synagogues, praying of men. But when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, shut the door behind thee, enter into your own mind, shut off your senses, and pray to thy Father. Commune with this presence which is within you. And so when we think about future memories, we can give them the same elevation in our mind as past memories. If we honor those that we have known in the past, it doesn't have to be military, incidentally, it can be just a loved one, a Memorial Day weekend, or any time throughout the year that we want to remember and honor, whether it's parents, children, loved ones, pets. Anything that has really touched our heart. Then we can go into the past, but also, as I'm going to suggest this morning, let us also honor future memories. Future memories that already exist. Future things that have already happened to you. You see, the mystery of life, and this is very, very subtle, is that we are a multidimensional being. Let me repeat that. A multidimensional being. Now, most people are concerned when they pass over from this life, they're going to go into another dimension. And then the thing is, which dimension am I going to go into? The good one or the bad one? Or maybe the in-between one? You know? Am I going to the Mormon dimension, the Catholic dimension? Am I going to the Baptist dimension? Am I going to the Buddhist dimension? Am I going to the Hindu dimension? Am I going to the New York dimension? Which dimension am I going to? Which one am I headed for? The idea is that you're already multidimensional. That's why when a person goes into a state of meditation, they may see into a Buddhist dimension. They may see into a Hindu dimension. They may see into a Christian dimension. How is this possible? It's possible because you exist in all of these dimensions simultaneously. Why? How is that possible? Because remember, the real you of you is God. So God exists everywhere in all dimensions. And if you begin to think about this, you begin to think of when the psalmist said, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Oh, that went far, far beyond the physiology of our body. It went far, far beyond any one concept of faith. It went into the very nature that we were indeed created in God's image, which has never left us and lives within us as the true self of ourselves. Fantastic. I mean, this unfolds us to something where we can say whatever will be already is. And to the degree that we accept it, according to your belief, be it unto you. I am healthy. Do you believe it in your heart? Then you have that archetypal image already existing in a health dimension of consciousness inside of you. Yes, it will manifest to you. It's your choice. In this life, there are many carrots dangled in front of us to make choices. Most people will choose the carrots that seem associated with this world. These carrots disappear overnight. It's only the eternal part of ourselves that we should be paying any attention to, because that's the part that goes on. And that's the part that is our literal salvation here on earth and beyond. Let's pull out our affirmation card. The first affirmation says, past memories. In my heart, I honor the memory of those I have loved and those dear to me who have passed on or are no longer a part of my physical life, yet remain an eternal part of God's presence within me, with which I am one. Now that could be somebody that served in the military, or it could be just a loved one, a mother, a father, a child, anyone that you've ever felt that beautiful closeness of love and affection to. At the same time, when it is a formalized type of Memorial Day weekend, such as here in the United States or in anywhere else in the world that celebrates anything spiritual or similar, the same situation applies to honor those that have gone before. When I was being brought up, I was a little child, it was the Second World War was going on, and I had a number of uncles that served in the military at that particular time. And I remember how many people lost their lives and their limbs and so forth during that conflict. And then I was part of the air squadron that had served in the Korean conflict. I joined it just as they had gotten back from Korea. And we had lost men there, the Air Force squadron. And I remember, of course, most of you here and listening in remember the Vietnam conflict, how gruesome that was, and in terms of the men lost, the ancient orange, all of the things that the people had to go through, and some of them still going through it when they returned here. All of these things are memories that we can honor of the past, and of course those that are currently serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. Again, whether you believe in that war, the justification of it or not, makes no difference. It is that people are, in their own minds, those that are in the military, in their own minds, giving themselves for a righteous cause. Sometimes I look at the young people of today that have never really seen war firsthand, never really known that their freedom to live their lives according to their choice has been given to them on the shoulders of people who gave their lives. In Christianity, we speak of Christ as having given his life for humanity. But I would say that every person that has ever laid down their life for another person, whether in war or whether they threw themselves in front of a car to save somebody else or whatever, that all of these people, all of these souls, a part of God, all to be remembered and honored in our past. And that we honor even those people before they have left us, where there are cultures today that honor elderly people, something which in the United States, unfortunately, has fallen to the wayside, and where here youth is worshipped at all cost. And the youth, unaware of what it has taken to give them that freedom and that democracy that they enjoy, go off on their own tangents. There are exceptions to every rule. But here, today, we live in a society, in a country, indeed a world, that is disintegrating before our eyes for the lack of honoring and respecting the noblest within ourselves that is God. It was very, very interesting to me this past week, where at the top of the New York bestseller lists in nonfiction, the books that were selling were books written by atheists against the concept of God. Now remember this, you can't sell anything unless there's a market for it. All of you agree on that? That shows the consciousness that this country has disintegrated to. That where atheistic books are on the bestseller list, not just one author, but three. What does that tell us? It sends us a message that partying, alcohol, drugs, and stupidity rule this country. The more that this country has become desensitized to the concept that we are part of a divine situation, the more the country's psyche collectively has gone into this state of intellectual isolation. Think about it. The more we have criticized the concept that even a God exists. Now, before it was just the concept where you have extreme factions of Christian religion. But now it doesn't make any difference if there is anything of a supreme consciousness that is being attacked. But the worst part about it is that there is a sale. Time and space. In fond memories of those close to me at some time in my life, I declare that neither the illusion of time and space separates them from me in the consciousness of God within me. We always said, well, when somebody passes on, they'll always live in my heart. Because we are one with an eternal consciousness, they will live on eternally. Fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, sons, daughters, whatever it might be, they live on. Love to special people who are part of memories past and memories to be lived in the future. I send you the greatest gift I can send you, my love. Memorial days. On Memorial Days, I especially take time to go back over the years to thank those who have meant so much to me in my life. As I'm finishing up a series of books, of putting together writings that I have written over many, many years now, and as I'm going over and putting dedication pages in these books, the dedications are to a great many people, to a great, great many people that have in some way helped me over the years, at some point had some influence, whether it was somebody who came in with a large donation when I didn't know whether I could keep someplace open or not, whether it was somebody who did not have the wherewithal financially, but gave their support to whatever I was attempting to do, their friendship, to those that have caused me to share laughter with them, to those that I have meditated with, to all of the people in my past, I give thanks. To every student going into the hundreds of thousands over a 50-year period, I give thanks. You've allowed me to live my life according to the purpose for which I was created. Not to war, but to try to bring peace to people's souls by reawakening them to the presence that is within them. Next it says, war. For those who I have not known, but who have sacrificed a portion of their body, mind, or entire physical life for me, I honor in gratitude eternally. Most of those that have given the ultimate price or have come back from a war with a portion of them left in a battlefield somewhere, all of those, none of us can ever know in this physical life consciously, but we can know in our heart that again, to that warrior, there was nothing more righteous than a noble war. And so when it comes to holidays, whether in this country or any country, where we seek to honor people that have contributed to others, it is really not a nationalistic situation. It is a thing of a total consciousness situation that exists on this planet and throughout the universe, where souls give themselves for the sake of other souls, where they portray the cosmic drama of God living through them. Realization. I realize that whatever life I am currently living will be a part of my future memories. That's very important for us to pause on. Whatever life I'm now living right here, right now, that's part of my future memories. Whether that be a week from now, a month, a year, or years from now, some of us may look back to this day. This week, this month, and thus I am especially motivated to express my love, friendship, affection, and gratitude to those close to me in the present who will be part of my memories in the future. So, do you have somebody that you love, that you feel a sense of affection for? Why not? Take a few moments, make a phone call, write a letter, a postcard, a greeting card, an email. Go high tech with your love. Eternity. That's a big word with a big reality connected to it. As much as we in a human perspective, bottled in by the illusion of time and space, run from this, the reality is that's where we're living. We're living in eternity. We're already here because it is each and every one of us. So it says, whatever has been or will be lives in one eternal moment of God's presence in oneness with my soul. Future memories. I honor God's presence for my divine origin, in whom memories of past, present, and future coexist as one eternal moment. Past, present, and future exist already, right here, right now. Christ said, the kingdom of heaven is here and now. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Consciousness, eternity, reality, here, now, your reality, my reality, everyone's reality, as one reality. Do not like someone is to not like yourself. To love someone is to acknowledge that that someone is you. To help someone is to help another part of you. To honor those that have given for you is to honor other manifestations of you. It's all one life. It's all one mind. It's all one spirit. It's all you and you and you and everyone looking in, it's you. Let's take a few moments now to enter into a state of meditation and to focus in on this presence. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me, that I may take a few moments to enter into a state of meditation here within myself, to leave the physical world and physical skies behind me, that I may enter into an inner sky, an inner world of mind, soul, and consciousness. To live in a state of inner reality. To move forth now into myself. To move through the corridors of my mind and consciousness. That I may pass into that sacred room of mind and awareness within myself, where the infinite and the eternal part of me has been, is, always will be. That part of me, the eternal part of me. That part of me that was before this physical body was. That part of me that will be long after this physical body is no more. That part of me that has traveled endlessly through eternity to be here and appear as what I appear to be now, only to a certain point leave this body and continue in another body, in another form, in another dimension, but always one with the eternal that created me, always one with my Creator. And in Christ-like awareness and consciousness of this, I surrender the intellectual part of my consciousness, the surface part of me, to the real me, to the Christ me ever one with God, to the eternal me, always one with the light that is within me and yet infinitely beyond me. I give of that to that which is holy. I give of my physical beingness and its perception to that which is infinite and eternal, the perception Christ-like of God in oneness with all that is. I yield my soul to the spirit of the infinite eternal God self, to God's presence in the upper room of consciousness within my own mind. Divine Spirit, absorb me into your light. Welcome me into your presence. You are my source. You are life eternal, with which I am one. And my meditation is an awakened memory of your reality. In godlike oneness, I am that which I am. I sit now for a few moments peacefully, allowing the greater reality that I am to be a part of every part of my mind, my body, and my soul. In a few moments now, I'll slowly begin to open my eyes, but retain that contact from the great within. And so now, ever so slowly, I'll begin to open my eyes. And as I do, and as my eyes and senses come back to the outer world, I stretch my arms and my hands and I high over my head, just in a symbolic gesture of reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars and of the heavens, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the peace and the security that this is so, and so it is.